Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Seeking Out Goodness, Finding the True and Beautiful All Around You by Alexandra Kuykendall, narrated by Em Eldridge. Introduction. You find what you're looking for. The morning's news headlines were a terrible welcome to a new day. CNN's homepage flashed these bullet points, begging me to click and get more. A man fell to his death while taking pictures on a cliff in Arizona. Authorities discovered other remains while recovering his body. Man pleads guilty to aggravated murder of University of Utah student in exchange for life sentence. A Texas family sued to keep their baby on a ventilator. The hospital says the child is dead. A dangerous virtual cult is going global. I closed my computer. Everything felt like bad news. Every headline brought more bleak information. Every Twitter take was tearing apart the opposite opinion. Every discussion dripped with sarcasm and dismissal of any idea that differed. Politics, pandemic, economic divides, racial tensions, violence near and far. Surely the world hasn't shifted to a place beyond hope, I thought. There must still be some good news for us as people, some love to experience, some goodness to be found. A few minutes later, as I scooped coffee grounds into the pot's filter, I couldn't shake the thought that the world is begging for good news. Jesus says, "Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly." Matthew chapter 11, verse 30. On most days, I do my darndest to follow Jesus, and yet I am anything but light and free. It feels more like I am dragging the world's despair. With each step, the load weighs heavier and my muscles are more fatigued, making it difficult to stay motivated, to keep believing goodness exists. Despite moments of overwhelm, I'm not ready to give up looking, because though I know life is hard, I also know it is beautiful. I call myself a kitchen anthropologist because I stand in my kitchen in Denver, Colorado, and observe the world around me, trying to make sense of why people are doing what they are and how that reflects on what they believe about God and one another. This morning was no different as I considered where God was still at work. Writing this book is part of my kitchen anthropology. I hold no special credentials other than a lot of observing and listening and seeking out goodness in the middle of my ordinary days. I think on questions like, how is God moving in this situation? Why do I think so? How are we, people who follow Jesus as Redeemer, especially prepared to deal with this right now? I took my coffee back to my home office and looked out the window to the beginning hints of a sunrise. Early mornings are my time, because that's when my house of five other people is quiet and I can think. Out the window, I could see the sky changing, pink, orange, and blue intensifying as the light got brighter. God was slowly turning up the dimmer switch on the day. I saw the colors through the branches and leaves of my neighbor's tree. The tree and all its parts looked black against the orange and pink. The contrast helped me notice both more easily. What I noticed depended on what I chose to focus on. My gaze out the window didn't change, but if I looked for the sunrise, the tree became a frame for the vibrant color. If I focused on the tree, the outline of the branches came into quick clarity. I was looking at both simultaneously, but what I was seeking out determined what I saw. What we know of God. This is a book about noticing. God's goodness is already here. We don't have to pretend it up, talk it into existence, or believe it to make it real. We know from Scripture that God is good, and we know He is the same today as yesterday and will remain the same tomorrow. So His goodness hasn't changed. We believe Him to be a loving Creator who makes all things new through His grace and redemption. And because we know this about Him, we can look for His goodness in all places. And we can point to it when we find it so that others can see it as well. We are meant to amplify who He is. Think of holding up a magnifying glass to His acts of love, His beautiful creation, His opportunities to love Him back and love others with refreshment, so that we can remember that goodness is still here. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. James chapter 1, verse 17, ESV. So every single good thing in this world can be traced back to Him. We remind ourselves and fellow Jesus followers of the truth, so we can spur one another on to live out the great commandments of loving God and loving others. This, in turn, will remind others of the hope found in Christ. We are not that hope. He is the hope. Our job as kitchen, cubicle, classroom, hospital, or any place we find ourselves, anthropologists, is to find echoes of His character and reflect them back to a world in need of good news. God's character, His love and mercy, is certainly good news. If this feels a little woo-woo right now, hard to get your mind and hands around, this book is meant to make the process more concrete. Examples of what this has looked like for me and for others are mixed with practices to help you in your search, so we can learn together what it means to seek out goodness. My hope is when you're done reading, you will have a better vision for what is good. It will jump out at you like the twists and turns of my neighbor's tree branches against the sunrise. Because you have focused in on what you are looking for and can extract what is good. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 tells us where to center our thought life. This verse will act as our structure as we intentionally focus on finding goodness. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. The promise follows in verse 9. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me, or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Paul is telling his fellow Jesus followers to think on this list of goodness and then reflect those traits with our own actions. God will be with us in every part of the process. As we use Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 as a roadmap for seeking out goodness, we will see how God demonstrates these qualities, how we are finding them around us, and how we can reflect them back to the larger world. We find what we're looking for. If you're like me, the world feels exhausting right now. Everything has become controversial. A battleground for partisan fighting that reflects nothing of what God says He wants for people. On top of the intense cultural moment, each of us carries the stress of living our actual lives. Parents are sick, bills need to be paid, kids have to be educated and raised to be productive citizens. The amount of responsibility we each carry within a climate that feels toxic and combative is nothing short of overwhelming. And yet we have good news. It's the good news that has followed humanity through every generational trial. God is with us. He has not changed. Though the political talking points, the community conflicts, and the pandemic devastation may have an intensity we haven't experienced before, He has. He has been with people through every human trial because he is, well, God. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Revelation chapter 21, verse 6. And he is not going anywhere. Though the ground we stand on feels unstable, he is unchanging and steady. Because he does not change, we know his goodness remains here. If we are to survive the heaviness that fills our days, we must seek out what is good. The darkness is real, but so is the light, and we know the light will overcome the darkness. John chapter 1, verse 5. So here is the million-dollar question. How? How do we seek out what is good when we feel paralyzed by what is difficult? How do we lift our heads enough? How do we make sure to hold on to the light in the midst of the darkness? That is what this book is about. How to search for, find, and recognize God's goodness. A Prayer for Seeking. Lord, we know you make all things new. You bring the sun up every day and the moon every evening. You are dependable in your consistency and surprising in your new growth. Your goodness is both reliable and refreshing. Open our eyes to where you are already at work. Remind us with each discovery that you will not leave us and you still have more to give. Help us to have new vision, a clarity that brings your goodness to the front of our minds, so that we may know more of you today, on this very ordinary kind of day. Let us find you in the vacuuming, raking, and scrubbing, in the wiping of tiers, bottoms, and counters, in the early morning light and midnight darkness, in the typing, driving, walking, snoozing, baking of our days, in the boredom, lovely, thrilling, and angst, in the wild and wonderful, the bland and predictable. In every part of our lives, may we see evidence of who you are. Holy Spirit, do a work in us so that we may reflect a teensy portion of God's goodness to our circles of people and creation on this planet. Help us to reflect mercy. Help us to offer grace. Help us to be reconcilers. Help us to be hope bearers, so that those who are also seeking goodness will find your essence in us. May we not be barriers to your good news, but amplifiers of it. We trust you with this journey. In Jesus and through Jesus we pray. Amen. Questions for reflection. 1. Where do you feel bad news most strongly? Where is there pain that overwhelms you? Is it old pain or new pain? 2. Do you believe there is goodness to be found? Why or why not? 3. What have you been seeking out? How is that reinforced by what you've found? 4. How have you seen good news? How does seeing it help you find more good news? 5. When considering what is true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, or praiseworthy, what do you think will be the easiest for you to spot in the wild? What will be the most challenging? Mining for the gold. Nana's grandfather came from Ireland. You could focus on him. 10-year-old Gracelyn had just come home from school and was anxious to get started on her new assigned project, a report on a person from her family who had immigrated to the United States. My grandfather on my mother's side was the son of an Irish coal miner. He was the first person to come to mind.
Okay, him.
Sometimes fourth graders are easy to please. And so we chose the mystery man we were labeling as Nana's grandfather. Graceland's great-great-grandfather. She was pleased. Now the first step was to find his name. William Hogan, my mom said when I called her. She said it with authority, so I was sure she was going to be a great resource on this assignment. Great. What else can you tell me? He worked in the coal mines near Gunnison. He died when Dad was 3 years old. Dad was the youngest of 10. Gunnison is a town on the other side of the Rocky Mountains from our home in Denver. It's a place where the city folk head to go whitewater rafting or camping. The hint of Colorado's history is palpable, with ranches that still operate and a mountain valley where it's easy to imagine settlers looking around and deciding to stay. My mom's knowledge of William Hogan stopped at the few pieces of information she gave me over the phone, his name and where he lived, and his occupation at death. She knew her own father's name and birth date. I had a vague memory that she'd told me as a child that William had left a brother on the docks in Ireland. One brother was boarding a ship to the United States, and the other was headed to Australia. Both off on their respective adventures, with no way of keeping in touch. No cell phones or emails. No forwarding addresses. As a child, I thought that story sounded slightly romantic and exciting. Now I hear desperation to make choices that would result in the grief of saying goodbye forever. It was time to do some research to find the details we needed for the project. As any amateur genealogist would do, I went to the internet, a place where mining is required, a sifting through of what is untrue, unessential, and unimportant to find the gems I was looking for. I told Graceland I would help her find the facts. Together, we would make educated guesses about the details, and she could write out William's story. We learned about coal mining in Colorado, the potato famine in Ireland, and traveled to the New World. And then, with all my internet scrolling, I found gold, a cemetery record in Gunnison, Colorado, that showed the birth and death years that lined up with my mother's memory. Then photos of a grave plot and shared tombstone for William and his wife, Sarah, my mother's namesake. Finally, the photo that made me gasp out loud as I realized what I'd discovered. The back of the tombstone had three engraved names with birth and death years. William and Sarah buried three of their children. Our search revealed that William Hogan's life was not only filled with the back-breaking work of climbing through the coal mines of our beautiful Rocky Mountains, it also contained the worst type of grief. Losing a child, three times over. This final photo was not what I was looking for, but it gave me a whole new understanding of this man's experience in his new world. It wasn't lost on me as I clicked from site to site that we were mining for information about a miner. The process of mining is seeking out. It is often a toil to whittle away at what is unnecessary to discover what we're looking for. It isn't always the joy of the gold rush, the cowabunga of the big surprise. It is the disciplined step of looking for the next thing and the next thing. It is having eyes to see where God is at work, even if it doesn't seem obvious at first glance. It is finding treasure in the middle of what looks like a mountain of rock. It is venturing into unknown places, often dark and dangerous spots, to get what is valuable. It is separating what is good from what is not. While my great-grandfather's mining work was difficult and sooty, it reminded me that the search for good can be hard. It is not meant for those who are looking for the easy, clean route. It is also the work of faith, because we must believe there is something worth seeking out if we are to go to all this trouble. We trust that there is a possibility that we will find treasure. Part 1. The truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God. Whatever is true. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Truth is so rare, it is delightful to tell it. Emily Dickinson. I sat in the jury box trying to focus on the judge's opening instructions. I heard only snippets of his monologue. A few days. No talking about the case. Breaks throughout the day. I was too distracted by the thoughts of my 4-year-old and nursing baby at my sister-in-law's for the day to give my full attention to the courtroom happenings. In the days that followed, my fellow jurors and I listened to expert witnesses with fancy credentials talk about medical protocols and medical records while technicians read phone message logs. We learned about kidneys. Lots about kidneys. We watched the clock and covered our stomachs with our notebooks when we could feel ourselves getting hungry and our tummies started to grumble. I'm kind of a natural juror. I like the thought of experts. I enjoy hearing both sides of a story and then deciding where I stand on the question at hand. I also like the idea of getting to the bottom of something and finding the truth. I took notes, studied faces for emotion, and wondered when our next break would be so I could call my sister-in-law, Lindsay, to check in again. The lawyers gave their closing arguments, and I walked into the jury room with confidence that this was a done deal. We could decide in 10 minutes of deliberating, where we would just confirm to one another that this medical malpractice case was a big waste of our time and lots of resources. A good and easy, not guilty verdict. You know where this is headed. I was quick to learn that we didn't all see the evidence presented to us pointing to the same obvious result. Here we were, 12 jurors with 12 different life experiences, moral codes, and cultural filters to interpret the same information in front of us. We agreed on a forewoman to lead us through the process. The group discussion started with a respectful tone and was kicked off by a few brave souls volunteering to speak into the awkward silence. We felt the responsibility of our decision, and we all had our own versions of the nursing baby waiting for us at home. So we wanted to take our time to do right by both parties and also get out of there as quickly as possible. The respectful tone faded, and I could hear strain and stress in people's voices. As it turns out, sifting through evidence to discern the truth can be hard. Since the beginning of time, people have been searching for what is true. The pursuit of truth forms our cultures, informs our decisions, and shapes our understanding of how and why life exists. We can cover some pretty big questions in our search and have many sources to draw from. As Christians, we believe the Bible is God's inspired word. It has authority, as does the Holy Spirit, who speaks directly to us and others. We are embodied souls, and our lived experiences reflect what is true of the world, the good and bad. Ultimately, we believe Jesus when he says, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." John chapter 14, verse 6. We turn to all these sources knowing they will enhance one another and reflect the same large story of the gospel with different hues and textures. In a world of fake news, the foundations of our faith give us guideposts of truth as we walk through our days. When searching for goodness, we are on the lookout for what is true and what is not. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 starts right off with whatever is true. The problem is figuring out what exactly is true. We can't help but look at life through the lens of our personal experiences, which shape our biases, assumptions, and preconceived ideas. This is how we end up with animated jury deliberations. So we try to examine things from multiple angles to see if we're missing something. The genius behind our peer jury system. We go back to the foundational truths of who God is and who we are in relationship to Him. We keep our eyes open for truth because we want more of God, and we start with the truth that God is good. The not guilty verdict I thought was so obvious turned out to be our decision in the end. But there was a lot of discussion to get us there. Agreeing on truth isn't automatic and almost always takes work. We don't need to be afraid of the truth. As a mother of four daughters, I've moderated a number of she said, she saids. Girl 1, Mom, she blank. Hit me, looked at me mean, took a bite of my cereal. Girl 2, I did not. As details come out, I often find that someone's first version is not exactly the full story. The longer the partial truth teller holds on to her unsubstantiated version, the more uncomfortable she gets because partial truth is unsatisfying, and hiding the truth takes a different kind of emotional work. Let's pause here, right at the beginning of part 1. And decide we need to be honest during our search for goodness. If we believe God to be who He says He is, just, faithful, merciful, loving, then we can pursue truth with freedom. We don't need to pretend away or deny or hide from what is happening around us because God's character doesn't change. Will full honesty be comfortable? Not always. But our pursuit is for truth, not comfort. If we trust God's character is unchanging, we can offer space for other people's questions and doubts because we know what is true will not change. We can also give ourselves permission to ask questions, seek reliable sources, and maintain curiosity as we learn more of the infinite God and how He operates in our finite world. We can hold to what we know is true, and with humility loosely grasp the details that are still unknown. In this process, we may find God's goodness in unexpected places, because we've put preconceived ideas and presumptions aside and allowed God to show us His truth in new ways. We will offer others a more honest faith when we share where we have doubts. To think on what is true sets our minds in the right place. It grounds us, keeping us away from things we fear or worry about that are not real. Much of our lives is spent considering, problem-solving, and worrying about things that aren't even true. One of my daughters might cling to her version of a story because she is worried she'll get in trouble or will look silly if she is honest. But hiding from the truth is way more painful than any consequence had she just come clean and apologized. These distractions keep us from noticing, experiencing, and celebrating what God has for us that is true. Truth helps us find goodness. The truth is good. In church circles, we often talk about balancing truth and grace. In this contrast, the truth is usually presented as the harsh schoolmarm, reality, while grace is more like the grandma baking cookies, warm and soft and full of forgiveness and all. Truth is seen as the unfiltered photo with the gray roots and wrinkles, and grace is the filter that removes the unsavory. Truth becomes synonymous with confronting sin, perhaps throwing in some judgment and a dash of shame. In other words, truth is not fun. In this way, it has gotten a bit of a bad rap, like somehow it is the bad news part of the good news. But grace is also truth. And the good news, God so loved the world that He came, is really good, we can reclaim truth to include good. The world is a harsh place. We don't need to seek out that reality. The world is also full of beautiful moments and evidence of God's love. Both are true. The beautiful is no less true than the painful. Sometimes we like to play hierarchy of truth. Going back to the bad news part of the good news, we assume the harsher the tone, the more true it must be. In our everyday reclaiming of truth, we can look for the beautiful. A full pantry, dragonflies, babies who flail their legs when a sibling is in view, the sound of wind in the treetops, and a perfect flip of a cake out of its pan. All true, none harsh. All God's good gifts for today. The good and the hard impact each other. They reverberate, changing each other's tone, shaping how we experience both. But the pain of this world doesn't negate the beauty, no matter how much we're told it does. In John chapter 8, verse 32, Jesus reminds the crowd outside the temple that following his teachings will be the key to freedom from their sins. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, after all. It is knowing the truth about God and living from it that will move us from hurt, grief, and disappointment to see what is true and beautiful. The truth about God. It makes sense that we start with what we know to be true about God. He is kind of the main way we're going to find goodness. God's Word, which was inspired by Him and written for all people in all times, is a good place to start. When I was talking with my friend Francie, she reminded me that we can filter things through God's meta-narrative of creation, separation, reconciliation, and redemption. This is the larger story of God at work that is echoed throughout time and place. We see this pattern in humanity's larger story, but we also see it repeated over and over in our own stories. The micro reflects the macro. When looking for what is true and beautiful, I ask how a situation or circumstance fits into God's meta-narrative. It helps me see what is true. Scripture is God's living word, meaning it can penetrate our spirits in a way that it wouldn't if it was just a bunch of old writing. We are meant to engage with it, meditate on it, think on it. It is the truth we can turn to over and over again that will point us toward hope. Scripture gives words to who God is. Here are a few things it tells us about God. God is holy. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. God is love. 1 John chapter 4, verse 8. God is consistent and unchanging. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. God offers grace and mercy. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 through 9. God provides. Matthew chapter 10, verse 29. Practices for considering God. Choose one of the descriptors of God listed and do one or more of the following. Close your eyes and ask yourself what that word means to you. Pray the entire phrase as you breathe. Inhale, God is. Exhale, loving. Write the phrase out multiple times. Consider the words as you write them. Consider how this truth impacts your heart, your circumstances, and your upcoming decisions. Remember a time when you haven't known this to be true of God. Write how you felt. Look up the verse referenced and memorize it. The truth about you. You've likely played the game Two Truths and a Lie, where a person tells a group of people three things about himself or herself, and the group has to decide which of the three is the lie. from youth groups to office retreats, it's meant to be a funny way to get to know new details about one another. It is kind of fun to pull from what I know of someone to make an educated guess. It makes sense that a coworker would be a master gardener, given the floral prints she always wears. Not so likely she's been to all 50 states, given she hasn't taken a vacation in 2 years. When it's my turn to share, I often freeze and give the worst possible, read most obvious answers. 1. I have 4 daughters. 2. I live in Denver. 3. My cat was in the circus? Not exactly nailing it. Unlike my circus cat answer, we can get really good at unintentionally playing this game with the world, putting half-truths out for others to consume. See social media. So much so that we get our own lies and truths about ourselves mixed up and can't untangle them in our own minds. Things that have been said to us or done to us or just our human nature can distort the truth to the point that we forget who we are. We take in fake news, and it becomes part of the truth we believe. From the beginning of the human story, that snake in the garden has liked nothing more than for us to believe the untruths the world throws at us. From marketing campaigns that tell us our lives would be better if we only had a given product, to our patterns of thinking that have narrowed in on our self-perceived shortcomings, we are constantly receiving messages about ourselves that are not true. The human experience is about our relationship with God and the world He created. As the only creatures on earth made in His image, we are in a unique place to feel, think, experience, bond, grieve, and celebrate. It is not just due to natural selection that we are different from the rest of the life on this earth. It is our God-given identity that allows us to experience the complex, rich lives that we do. We are looking for God's goodness, and it is found in the truth of who we are. Remember that in the beginning, when He created us, God called His creation good. The creation part of the big story is that He made us and called us good. Here are a few reminders of who you are in the meta-narrative. The redemption part of your story. You are made in God's image. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 27. You are a sinner. Romans chapter 3, verse 23.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.